Taming.
Hi, Miss Karen. Thank you. Good morning.
Yeah, don't call me Miss Karen. Karen is fine. But I wanted to say just offhand, you are the splitting image of your father.
Thank you. I'll take that as a compliment.
Yeah, but do they often say that?
Yes, they do.
Okay, so why did you enter showbiz?
I was never interested in showbiz. I was actually very shy growing up. I hated the spotlight. I didn't like the fact that my parents were famous. But eventually, as I grew up, I got comfortable with it and grew more comfortable in my own skin. But showbiz was definitely never an option.
So you clearly carved your own path. I mean, you were the number one counselor in 2016, and you're 29 years old. And people may wonder, why would you risk your political career? You could have run for counselor again and be number one, or run for vice mayor and possibly win shoe-in. Why mayor? How did you tell your parents? What made you decide?
Well, actually, you mentioned my parents. When I first mentioned it to my parents, the first reaction was, huh? Sigurado ka ba dyan?
Of course.
But when I explained to them my reasons, when I explained to them was that now is the best time for someone to challenge the incumbent family, because that's what they are. They're an incumbent family. We've had four mayors with one last name for the last 27 years, and I strongly believe that now is the right time.
Okay, but how did you end up deciding it? I mean, did you pray? Did you wake up one day? What happened?
It was a long period of thinking about it. It wasn't an easy decision. A lot of prayers, a lot of consultation with different leaders, different stakeholders in Pasig. But the message was very clear that someone needs to run. If I didn't run, no one else would have run.
Yeah. But there must be something in the leadership that you feel is not serving the city enough. Why do you think that a change is needed? Isn't it run in a way that it should be? I mean, you have the Be Nice in Makati. Mm. I mean, I'm not saying I agree to it. Mm. I'm just challenging you and saying, what's lacking in Pasig? What aren't they doing right?
When I became a counselor, the first thing that I saw right away was that there are actually two Pasig cities. The West Pasig City, that's where you have Ortigas, Capitolio. It's very nice. If you just stay in that area, you'd think that everything is going smoothly. It's very progressive. It's great. But when you go to the east side of Pasig, across the Marikina River, near the Pasig River, that's where you'll see that a lot of Pasigueños are still in poverty.
Okay.
A lot of Pasigueños still live in informal settler communities. They haven't received, or they haven't felt the progress of the city.
And why? What do you think, as Mayor Eusebio, what hasn't he done? I mean, well, four Eusebios, you said. I mean, 27 years of Eusebios, what haven't they done?
From what I've seen as a councillor, their focus is really income generation. We have a huge budget, 10.7 billion pesos, one of the biggest in the entire country. But it's surprising that how come we have 10.7 billion pesos, but things as basic as healthcare, the hospital is nice, the infrastructure is nice, the equipment is new. Yeah. It was renovated last year, but you go to PCGH or General Hospital, there are no medicines. So ang ganda ng hospital, wala naman gamot. Ano nangyayari? But there's a huge budget, so there's something really wrong going on.
Okay, I'm curious, did you notice this when you were a counselor?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And did the council act on anything?
Well, it's sad to say, our city council, the councillors are all my friends. No? We're all in good terms, but the sad thing is that the city council has become a rubber stamp of the mayor.
Yeah.
There's not much discourse, no discussion. If the mayor gives an ordinance, it will be passed within a week.
Yeah.
This
is the classic David and Goliath story, I mean, in politics. What strategy do you have for you to win?
Well, I like the ending of that David and Goliath story.
Yeah. Okay.
It's really a guerrilla type campaign. Just go anywhere, strike anywhere. We don't have the funds that they have.
Yeah.
Well, they have the machinery. They have the machinery of City Hall. As I said, 10.7 billion pesos. It's not going to be easy, but if I believe that if we spread the message of change, of real, authentic change, not just the change in the face of the mayor, not just the change in the name of the mayor, but the change in the system and the culture of palakasan.
Oo.
And the culture of patronage and yeah. the fear, the culture of fear that they've set in the last 27 years.
Okay, I'm quite this is quite interesting because you're running for mayor, you don't have a vice mayor.
Right.
And instead you're campaigning with Roman Romulo, who is running for Congress.
Yes.
It's such a unique mix that you're running for mayor, Roman's running for Congress, you don't have your own slate, mm-hmm. so to speak. Why didn't you go that way?
I've always done things a bit unconventionally, and I believe that if you know, if I'm going to keep my idealism and go to this race and try to do things that challenge the traditional politics, challenge the traditional politicians or trapos, I need to do things in a totally different way. Yeah.
But when you say totally different way, how do you do it locally when vote buying is rampant locally? People pay watchers. I mean, I talk to politicians and they say the budget now hits 5,000 to 10,000 per voter through allowances, through gifts, libreng bigas, libreng ganito. How do you change that system, Vico?
Right, it's not going to be easy. I know that. Hindi naman po ako naive. But, you know, definitely vote buying for me is a no. We're not going to do that. Of course, some leaders, they'll have allowances, but very minimal in our case. If I want to be a leader who will win and not be corrupt, I have to not spend that much money.
Yeah.
Kasi yun naman po yung nangyayari sa atin. Eh. Politicians will spend millions upon millions of pesos. Pag upo nila, siyempre babawiin nila yun.
Oo. So let's talk about the eastern part of Pasig, yes. which you mentioned. No, you your advocacy is first is healthcare. So you talked about the budget of Pasig, which is 10.7 billion. And you said in an interview that only 2.4 billion is technically needed to implement universal healthcare in
correct,
Pasig.
Correct.
So why isn't it implemented? Where does the 10 billion go?
Well, only they can answer that. I don't understand why there are no medicines in our public hospitals yeah. and health centers. We even have what they call super health centers. Sometimes when they give medicines, it's almost expired or expired already. So malinaw po na may mali po talaga sa sistema. We need to introduce a better healthcare IT system. We need to put funds. But really, at the end of the day, it's not just about putting funds. It's about making sure that the funds don't go to private pockets. Mm-mm. Hindi napupunta sa corruption.
Bo, napupunta ba ngayon sa corruption?
Well, hindi naman po sekreto na laganap pa rin ang katiwalian sa gobyerno.
Mm-mm.
I think we would be joking ourselves if we said that there's no corruption in Pasig or in the Philippines in general. Hindi lang naman sa Pasig. But we would be kidding ourselves if we would say that there's no corruption in our LGU.
Okay, when you were a counselor, you filed the Freedom of Information Ordinance.
Right.
It passed in Pasig.
Yes.
But is it being practiced?
Right now, I don't think it's being implemented yet. It's already due for implementation because it was passed last year.
Yeah.
In the ordinance, it said 60 days for the passage of the publishing of a manual, Freedom of Information manual, but so far wala pa.
Okay. How would you improve the eastern side of Pasig? I mean, in terms of poverty, I'm just gonna read it. You can correct me along the way. This is research. The Manggangan floodway, for example, just last October 2018, I think they demolished over 1,000 homes.
The east part, the east bank.
Yes. Is that correct?
Yes. The east bank was demolished. The west bank, a lot of them are still there.
Okay. If you were mayor, would you do the same thing? How would you change housing in that part?
No, because the housing, the demolition that they did was actually illegal, and it was violent. The process was not done properly. They did not go through the process of consultation.
Okay.
Hindi po tama yung naging proseso ng consultation. They invited groups that they knew would say yes, but the groups that they knew would say no. In the Rosario floodway area and the Maybunga floodway area, they did not consult.
Oo. Tanong ko lang, so kapag mayor ka, how would you address that?
Well, una po yung consultasyon. Kailangan, yeah. bago tayo mag-demolish, kailangan maayos muna yung relocation uh-huh. site.
Are they back there?
A lot of them have gone back to Pasig.
Okay.
Not in the East Bank because they fenced it
yeah.
out. But a lot of them went back to the West Bank. A lot of them went back to Pasig. They were relocated in far-flung areas. A lot of them were relocated in Tanay, in Laguna.
So is this a style of Mayor Eusebio? Do you feel it's high-handed? Processes aren't followed. Is this
yes.
the way it is?
Siguro nasanay po kasi siya na dikta niya yung nasusunod. Hindi siya po marunong magkonsulta sa tao. And this is something that we've seen repeatedly, not only in housing, but even with transportation ordinances and policies for the tricycle drivers. Kulang talaga po sa consultation.
Okay, in terms of, I've read opinions on passing wherein talk about tricycles, jeepneys, they call it, it's a bit chaotic in
yes.
Pasig City. How would you change that and put some order into it?
Right. We need to come up with a better traffic management plan, or what the experts call now a mobility management plan. Hindi lang, we're not trying to move cars, we're trying to move people. Kasama na po dyan yung better training of traffic enforcers. We should remove the quota system para hindi huli yung focus, kung hindi yung daloy ng trapiko yung focus ng mga enforcers.
May a lot of different things. Ngayon.
I don't know if it's official, definitely required sila na ubusin yung mga paniket nila in a certain time period, say
okay.
1 month, isang ganun.
Another issue about Pasig, which is quite sad, is it hit the news many years back because one of the first Shabu Tiangges,
mm-hmm.
that term was actually coined coming from a raid in Pasig behind the mayor's office.
Yes, in
the Shabu Tiangges, exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Then December 2018, 30 kilos of chemicals used to make Shabu was found. November 2018, 300 grams of Shabu. Last October, Pasig RTC convicted 3 Chinese found also in Pasig.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, when you read the news, it doesn't look good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But ganun ang droga sa Pasig?
Again, they should be the ones to answer that question. But definitely, kung nakita po natin that there have been several Shabu Tiangges raids, there was one in, it was years back, no? more than a decade.
Uh-oh, but that's
and then
also,
the last one was
that's
2014.
That's how you said your leadership.
Correct. It's the same. And after that, 2006, I think, that was the first Shabu Tiangges raid. And then there was also one in 2014. So, malinaw po siguro na... I'm not going to make an accusation.
Yeah.
I think if we make accusations, there should be due process. And kahit po kalaban ko siya, hindi ko siya akusahan. But malinaw naman po siguro that, you know, it's there and they're there.
Yeah.
So kailangan po siguro ng change in leadership if we really want something to change.
Okay, pero how would you change that?
Hmm.
If the system, yung sindikato, ang lalim na, paano mo babaguhin yun?
Hmm. Well, again, it's not going to be easy, but definitely we need a change in leadership if we want to really address the issue. We'll actually need help from the national government, from PDEA, from the national PNP, kasi malinaw po na hindi talaga kaya within Pasig lang. But also, again, we need to focus on the other side also, the demand side of drugs. Hindi lang puro supply side yung tinitira. Ibig sabihin, kailangan po natin magpatayo ng rehabilitation centers.
Mm-hmm. So would you support Opland Tokhang if you were a mayor? Hypothetically, I mean, we have Bato already running for the Senate, but let's say you win as mayor and Duterte says, Opland Tokhang, ituloy yan. What do you think of the drug war, the way President Duterte did it?
I'll support anything that has due process.
So would you support the Opland Tokhang that was implemented?
Well, I hope there are some changes. Yeah. Tokhang in the sense of knocking people's doors and asking them to surrender, I think that's okay.
Okay, but what's not okay?
Kung titirahin natin yung may hirap, papatayin po kagad without... But, you know, I'm not saying that's happening.
Yeah.
But kung yun yung mangyayari, I wouldn't support that.
Okay.
But if it's just knocking at their doors and asking them to surrender, go through voluntary rehabilitation, I think that's a good program.
Okay. I'm curious, do you think the death penalty would help? I mean, it's being talked about now. Do you think it would help curb drug use, drug sales in the Philippines, even in Pasig?
Well, I'm a data person. I'm an analytical person. And when I look at data in other countries, drug penalty has not curbed crime.
Death penalty, you mean?
Sorry, go on. Death penalty has not curbed crime. There's no evidence to show that it's effective in deterring criminals.
So how would you deter? I mean, what would be the effective way to really stop local street drug use? I mean, it's not just in the Philippines. It's a worldwide issue. If it's not the death penalty.
Right. Enforcement of crime. Hindi naman po yung severity ng punishment, kundi yung katiyakan ng punishment. So dapat mahuhuli talaga. And the rule of law is in place.
Okay. If you were mayor, how would you change the way the 10.7 billion is spent?
Okay. The first one would be to allocate a little bit more with healthcare. So 2.4 billion pesos, that's the amount that I would like to earmark for healthcare expenses so we can fully implement universal healthcare.
Okay.
Libre na lahat ng gamot, libre na yung mga laboratory exams, 2.4 billion would be good. Second, I would reduce infrastructure spending. Kasi ngayon po, magpapagawa ng elevated walkway, tawiran lang ng mga tao, umaabot ng 100 million yung budget. I think that's too much.
Yeah.
Wala naman masama sa elevated walkway.
Oo. Huwag lang ganun.
Huwag lang ganun yung presyo. Parang sobra naman po yun.
Ang konseho ba hindi iniimbestigahan yun?
No, wala.
Okay, but go on. So your elevated walkways in Pasig are 100 million?
There's another one that was 80 million. So okay. Hindi lang isa.
Okay.
I saw several bidding documents already for a 2 billion peso sports complex. Again, wala pong masama sa mga infrastructure program na to. But
where would you put the sports complex? I mean, parang ang sikip na ng Pasig.
It's in Barangay Rosario.
Okay, go on.
But may space naman po, yeah. Pero magiging masikip. But anyway, that's not the point.
Why is it 2 billion?
The priority of expenditures. Siguro hanggat marami pang naghihirap na Pasigenyo, unahin muna para yung mga proyekto na makakatulong para makaahon sila mula sa kahirapan. Healthcare is a big anti-poverty measure.
Okay. I'm curious. So you want to set aside technically 1/4 of the 10.7 billion peso budget to healthcare. Mm-hmm. Where else is it spent, the rest of the 10 billion in Pasig?
Again, I think infrastructure spending is a little bit too high now. Maayos na kalsada, binabakbak, tapos gagawin ulit. So, malinaw po talaga na pwede natin babaan yung infrastructure spending, put it to health. The others, medyo okay naman po. Education spending is, I think, is in the right number right now. Kailangan na lang mas maging smooth yung implementation and yung mga requirements sa mga bata who receive scholarship or financial grants, for example. Dapat babaan ng konti yung mga requirements. Ngayon, required sila mag-attend ng parada, napapa-absent pa sa school. So, marami pong ganun na. Yun, minor tweaking na lang. But in terms of changing how the budget is spent, it's really reducing infrastructure, increasing health and livelihood programs to target poverty, to reduce poverty in Pasig.
Do you think the corruption in Pasig is in the infrastructure spending, frankly?
Well, the entire Philippines, I think, yun naman po talaga. Diba? SOP, it's standard operating procedures. Yun na yung tawag sa kanya, standard na siya. Mm-hmm. So parang normal na talaga sa atin.
And you think if you win, you can resist this temptation,
yes,
frankly? I mean, in the mayor's office, if somebody just drops over, like let's say 500,000 a day coming from illegal vendors, that's the collection, can Vico Soto say, you know what, please don't, I mean, can you do that?
Yes, I would return the money. And I think I've had the track record. You know, as a councillor, I have not accepted 1 peso of money from any kickback or any contractor. I know being a mayor will be difficult, but I believe I'm equipped. But I know it's going to be difficult. But resisting corruption, I think that will be my strong suit.
So, tanong ko, how are you funding your campaign?
It's a difficulty. Napakahirap po. Kasi I've actually rejected some offers.
Why?
May hinihingin ka palit eh. Kung manalo ka, akin na lang yung kontrata ng ex.
Wala ka na,
it's a disadvantage for me right now.
How are you raising funds? I mean, is your dad helping you?
Yes, he's helping me. Thankfully, he's there. But of course, I'm not going to ask my dad to spend 10 million for me to run for mayor. Pinaghirapan niya yung pera na yun. Again, wala po tayong babawiin. So, I don't want him to spend that much. Mahirap po talaga. I'll be honest with you.
Lang, how are you spending? I mean, I don't know. You have enough money at 29?
I don't have enough money. So kung meron po diyang mga honest na gustong tumulong.
Pasig. May interest sa Pasig.
Yes.
Tanong ko lang.
Or actually, mas maganda po kung walang interest sa Pasig.
Okay.
Gusto lang tumulong
now,
talaga to bring new politics.
Who do you turn to for advice when it comes to making decisions?
Okay.
Is it your dad, Vic Soto? This is for the audience, or your mom, Connie Reyes?
Both of them. They have very different perspectives.
Yeah. Are they in speaking terms?
Yes. Oh, good. I'm happy. They were there on the first day of the campaign.
Okay.
Pareho
okay.
Po silang nandun. They've been friends for ever since naman.
You know, it's quite interesting because you turned out, it seems, to be such a level-headed guy. You're very down-to-earth. And you took a political science pa in Ateneo. You even had a master's degree in public management in Ateneo. Mm-hmm. I mean, some kids from famous showbiz parents who separate, I mean, either get very confused or messed up in life. How did you cope with your parents' very public separation when you were young?
I would have to give a lot of the credit to my mom.
Okay.
Kasi I grew up with her.
Yeah.
I'm close now to my dad, especially as I've gotten older. But yung mom ko talaga, she made sure that I was grounded. And she made sure that I had multiple anchors, so to speak.
Yeah.
So, pastors in church who mentored me.
Yeah.
And then as I graduated college, mentors from civil society. So, yung pinangkukuhanan ko po ng lakas at kaalaman, multiple perspectives. So I think that's what really keeps me grounded, and it's what keeps me honest even as I enter politics.
Yeah. I'm curious, was there any point when you were young that you resented your father?
No.
I mean, you know how sons are when their moms hurt, or children generally, and they always side with the mother. You know, how did you, was there a point?
Well, between the two of them, I will really side with my mother. But
okay.
I would have to also...
When you were growing up, did you resent your father in any way?
My dad is very good. He's been a great father to me.
Yeah.
Even if we don't spend a lot of time with each other, especially growing up, I would see him maybe once a week. But he would make sure that he would see me at least once a week.
Yeah.
So I have to thank him for that.
Okay. The biggest misconception, of course, with comedians and stars is either, they're not smart enough or whatever. And it's been proven to be untrue.
Mm.
Okay. You have your uncle, Senate President Tito Soto, who's overcome all odds and just pursued his dream of being a senator despite all criticism when he was much younger.
Okay.
Is he one of your role models? Are you close to him?
He gives me some advice.
Okay.
I talk to him from time to time. I have full respect for him. I think he's, he's someone who doesn't, he takes his job very seriously.
Uh-oh.
I see that he really prepares
for
it.
Did you ask his opinion if you should run for mayor? Yun totoo.
Before I filed.
Of course. You didn't ask Tito Sen.
No, I talked to my parents and other
okay.
people. But
so
wasn't
what
able
is
to talk
his reaction now that you filed? Vico, you're crazy. No, I'm kidding.
Hindi naman po. Well,
ano sabi
after
niya?
I filed, he texted me a very positive message and expressing his support. Yes.
Okay.
I'm very thankful to him.
I'm curious, when you're out on field, do you ever worry that if you do, if you win, that's great.
Mm-hmm.
But what if you lose?
Well,
would you still enter politics after?
I wouldn't give an answer now. I'll cross the bridge when I get there. But I'm not afraid of losing. I believe that we have a good chance to win, but I'm not afraid to lose. If I was afraid, I wouldn't have run.
Okay. Why local government? I mean, you have a famous family name. You already have a Soto in the Senate. you're good looking. I'm sure you can put on the charm when you're on television and you have track record. Some people might say, why not run for the Senate? You know, it's name recall for many, as you've seen in the
I'm
top 12.
I'm only turning 30, Ms. Karen.
So you might.
No, I'm not qualified to run for the Senate, 35 years old.
I don't know, but are you open?
Well, again, I would cross the bridge when I get there. Wala naman akong ambition sa ganyan. I think I'm here now. I'm in a position to introduce real and long-lasting change in my city. So 100% of my focus is there.
Pero are you more local than you are national?
Right now, I think so, yes. It's what I've studied. It's what I've had experience in even before running for politics. So I think this is what I'm good at right now.
Pero in the future, the Senate is a possibility.
I'm open to it, but right now, wala naman.
Okay, Vic Lima is watching right now. Hello, Vic. He's asking, do you plan to use showbiz people in your campaign? It's a legitimate question.
I haven't invited anyone, pero Siyempre, like, for example, my parents. I can't choose who my parents are.
That's true.
So, and minsan, may dinadala silang kasama, but I will avoid showbiz rallies, showbiz caucuses. So, walang sayawan, walang kantahan.
Gagawin mo walang ganun? Eh, kung sa Senado nga, ginagawa nila. Talagang
well, I really want to do things differently.
Wow.
And
good for you.
I've always been a bit cautious about showbiz politics as I want to introduce and forward a politics that focuses on the issues.
Yeah.
Focus. Who I am, my parents, wala na po akong magagawa dun. You know, the celebrity factor is there. We'll use it. It's an advantage. No problem with that. But hindi na yung para gagawin kong lahat celebrity, puro fanfare, concert dito, concert doon. Hindi ko po gagawin yun. We go there, we go to a certain place, we talk about the issues, we talk about our platform, we talk about why we need change. Yun lang po.
Okay.